Good morning to all. Today's topic is on periodontal pockets. Learning outcomes are classify periodontal pockets, explain the pathogenesis of periodontal pockets, describe the contents and wall of periodontal pockets, display the skills in identification, evaluation and measurement of periodontal pocket in clinical situations, analyze all possible treatment modalities for periodontal pocket. Introduction. What is periodontal pocket? It is a pathologically deepened gingival sulcus. As you know, gingival sulcus is a shallow crevice or space around the tooth which permits the periodontal probe, the entrance of periodontal probe, bounded by tooth on one side and epithelial lining the free margin on the other side. So this pathologically deepened gingival sulcus or the periodontal pocket, it could be due to the coronal movement of the gingival margin or the apical displacement of the gingival margin. So that is periodontal pocket. So we can classify under various categories. The important one is that the gingival pocket and periodontal pocket, as we said, gingival pocket is due to the coronal migration gingival margin, that is truly without the destruction of underlying periodontal tissues, and it is also called as pseudo pocket. Periodontal pocket occurs with the destruction of the supporting periodontal tissues, that is the pathological deepened gingival sulcus, that is truly with the destruction of periodontal tissues, that is otherwise called true pocket. So that is based on the laws of attachment. You can see the gingival pocket, that is mainly due to the coronal migration of the gingival margin or gingival enlargement without destruction of the underlying periodontal tissues. The sulcus deepen because of the increased bulk of the gingiva. So that is otherwise called false pocket. Whether in this you can see that it is a true pocket, that is due to the destruction of periodontal tissues, that is otherwise called true pocket or absolute pocket. So this progressive pocket formation deepening leads to the destruction of periodontal tissues, and which ultimately leads to loosening and exfoliation of teeth. So next is based on the location of the base of the pocket in relation to the underlying bone. So it is in relation to the underlying bone. So first one is supra-bony pocket. As the name indicates, it situates above the bony crest, that is it is supracrestal or supra-alveolar. So the bottom of the pocket is coronal to the underlying alveolar bone. So in this intra-bony pocket, that is otherwise called infra-bony subcrestal or intra-alveolar pocket, in this you can see that this bottom of the pocket is apical to the level of the adjacent alveolar bone. So coming to the differences between supra-bony pockets and infra-bony pockets, as we said, that is supra-bony, it situates above the bone, and infra-bony pockets, it involves the bone, that is apical to the crest of alveolar bone. So and the pattern, when we discuss about the bone destructive pattern, it's more like horizontal. You can see that bone destructive pattern is more like horizontal, and whereas in this infra-bony pockets is more like angular pattern of bone destruction. So interproximally, and also the transeptal fibers like situated in the interproximal region is restored during the progressive periodontal disease are arranged horizontally, same as that of the pattern of bone. And whereas in infra-bony pockets, it's like oblique. So other than that, on facial lingual surfaces, periodontal ligament fibers beneath the pocket also follow the normal horizontal oblique course between the tooth and bone, whereas periodontal fibers follow angular pattern of adjacent bone in infra-bony pockets. Next is based on the involved tooth surfaces. It has been classified into simple, compound and complex. The first one is very simple, that is which involves only one tooth surface. Here you can see that it involves only one surface, either it can be mesial, distal, buccal or lingual. So that is the simple one. And compound one, it involves more than one surface, that is when it involves two surfaces. Here you can see that it involves both the buccal as well as the mesial surfaces. And the other one is complex type, that is it is like more like spiral type of pocket, that is which opens in one end, entrance will be in one end and exit will be in the other end. That is why it is called spiral type of pocket. It is mostly seen in the furcation area, as you can see in this picture, the complex type of periodontal pocket. So next, coming to the nature of pocket wall, you can see like edematous type of pocket wall and fibrotic type of pocket wall. In edematous pocket wall, so it mainly depends upon the healing of pocket. That is edematous pocket wall, that is where inflammatory fluid and cellular exudate predominate. You can see that this here it is very like bluish red, soft, spongy and friable with a smooth shiny surface. This is the edematous type of pocket wall. And you can see that fibrotic pocket of pocket wall, that this will be like hiding this actual edematous pocket wall. So that is here like fibrotic content will be more predominant. So there is a relative predominance of newly formed connective tissue cells and fibers that we will see clinically more than the edematous type of pocket wall. And this pocket wall will be more firm and pink. So that is usually like hiding the actual edematous pore. So that is depending on the disease activity, so it can be classified into active and inactive pocket walls. So next, coming to the clinical signs of periodontal pocket, you can see the first one, that is the most evident one, is gingiva appears as bluish red. That is most in the established lesion. That is mainly we can see that gingiva becomes bluish red. You can see with the thickened margins or rounded or rolled out margins, and this bluish red vertical zone could extend to the attached gingiva as well. And this you can see that this is rolled out enlarged edematous gingiva. So the color will be changed and it will be extended and there will be enlargement can be seen. And also the bleeding on probing can be seen. And also sometimes you can expect the separation. And also if it is extending and when it reaches the bone level and when there is bone loss, it leads to tooth mobility. And also the extrusion of teeth can be seen. And sometimes there is pathological migration also, which leads to the diastema formation as well. Then coming to the symptoms that patients tell usually or complains to you, that is mostly because of this localized pain or pain deep in the bone, or the patient might be complaining about the urge in the pain or tiredness can be said, or it can lead to foul taste also. Sometimes the patient might experience foul taste and also bleeding gums from gum during brushing or during mastication. And also sometimes the patient would experience sensitivity to hold cold and hot food. And also toothache in the absence of caries might be mainly due to the periodontal issues that we can see. And also this pus drainage also can be seen with localized swelling. So these are some of the symptoms of periodontal pockets. So we have discussed the clinical features, that is symptoms and signs, and now we are discussing about histopathological features, so the reasons behind each clinical feature. The most important one, that is the bluish red discoloration, that is what we are telling, that is the first sign, or the color change. So that is after bleeding or probing, this is the first sign, that is the discoloration. That is the color change is mainly due to the circulatory stagnation, that is the venous stasis, that is mainly seen in the established lesion. That is the third stage of gingivitis. And then comes the flaccidity, that is because of the destruction of gingival fibers. Smooth shiny surface, that is mainly due to the atrophy of epithelium and edema. Then pitting on pressure is due to edema and degeneration. And this, sometimes gingiva appears, that is that already we discussed, that the periodontal pocket that appears pink and firm, that is when the fibrotic changes predominate. And the bleeding on probing, that is the main first sign of gingivitis or periodontal pocket formation, that is the increased vascularity, thinning of degeneration of epithelium and proximity of engorged vessels to inner surface. So these are the main reasons for bleeding on probing. Then pain on probing, that is definitely due to the ulceration of inner aspect of pocket wall. So that is the pain on probing. And then comes the pus by digital pressure, that is by the separating inflammation of inner wall. Coming to the theories of pocket formation, so various theories have been put forward by various authors. There is first one, that is Wilfrid Wisch in 1949 proposed that the pocket formation is mainly due to the destruction of gingival fibers. That is a prerequisite for the initiation of pocket formation. And second one is that by Gottlieb, 1946, the initial change in the pocket formation occurs in the cementum. So he has put forward that the concept that initial change in pocket formation occurs mainly in the cementum. And the third one, what they are telling, that is by Eisenberg, that is 1948, that is stimulation of the junctional epithelium by inflammation rather than destruction of the gingival fibers is the prerequisite for the initiation of periodontal pocket. That is, the stimulation of junctional epithelium by inflammation is more responsible for the formation of periodontal pocket. Then the next one is by Skillen, 1930, he proposed that pathologic destruction of junctional epithelium due to infection or trauma, there is a main initial histology change in pocket formation, though, so that would be the reason for the pocket formation. And next is by Keith, 1941, the periodontal pocket is initiated by the invasion of bacteria at the base of the sulcus or absorption of the bacterial toxins through the epithelial lining of the sulcus. That is the that is one that is proposed by Keith in 1941. And then in 1949 by Hermann Bux, told that pocket formation is initiated as a defect in the sulcus wall. Then Wilkinson, 1935, told that proliferation of epithelium of the lateral wall rather than epithelium at the base of the sulcus is responsible for the pocket formation. And then in James and Consul, 1927, put forward the two-stage pocket formation. That is, first stage is that is the proliferation of junctional epithelium. And second stage is that the loss of superficial layers of the proliferative epithelium, which produces a space or pocket. Then finally, Nichols J. He put forward that the main idea behind the periodontal pocket, or main reason behind the periodontal pocket, that is the inflammation. Inflammation is the initial change in the formation of periodontal pocket. That is what we are telling, that the initial stage is the gingivitis. So initial lesion in development of periodontitis is the inflammation of gingiva. That is the gingivitis caused due to the bacterial challenge. So that is bacterial challenge. You can see that as when we compare the healthy gums with the periodontal, like periodontal case, and we are telling that healthy gums we will be having beneficial bacteria, that is more with coccoid cells and straight rods, whereas in like gingivitis case and periodontitis case, there will be more amount of bacteria cells, that is with spirochetes and motile rods. So this is the reason behind the pocket formation. Told that inflammation is a prerequisite for periodontal pocket formation. So that is gingivitis, which leads to periodontal pocket formation. When it is progressed, it leads to periodontitis. So before going to the details of pocket formation, first we would like to explain about the gingivitis and its various stages. So first one, that is what occurring in the initial lesion, that is after the 2 to 4 days of plaque accumulation, you can see that there is various changes. Clinically, you can see that gingival fluid flow. And the immune cells predominate, that is a PMNS defense cells is predominate. And also you can see like some amount of perivascular loss. And the blood vessels will be vascular dilatation and vasculitis. And next stage, so after this 4 to 7 days, you can just, it will get progressed into early lesion that you can see, with vascular proliferation and retipix and atrophic areas, and here the lymphocytes predominate and also increased loss around infiltrate. And the clinically you can see the red color, it is reddened gingiva or erythema and also bleeding on probing. And then comes, when this progress to the next stage, that is the third stage, that is established lesion, that you can see there will be more enlargement and also bluish red. You can see that is mainly occurs in 14 to 21 days, that is blood stasis, that is a stage 2 plus. You can see that the circulatory stagnation, that is more advanced, and here you can see that plasma cells predominate and also there will be continued loss of collagen and also there will be change in all the texture, color, and size. So there will be enlargement. So it could be due to coronal migration and of gingival margin. That also leads to periodontal pocket. And if it is not going to subside here or it's not going to be treated here, it will progress to the next level. So that is advanced lesion periodontitis or with the destruction of supporting tissues. So then coming to the pocket formation, as we said that inflammatory process that is mainly occurs with the accumulation of supragingival plaque and then leads to change in color. When there is increased inflammatory response, there will be change in color to redden gingiva, and also there will be some of the changes dilated engorge or vessels, like dilatation can be seen. That is mainly occurs with the initial stages of gingivitis. That is, inflammatory change in the connective tissue wall of the gingival sulcus happens in the initial stage. So then what happens? There will be increased cellular and fluid inflammatory exudate, which causes the degeneration of surrounding connective tissue, including the gingival fibers. So that you can see this inflammatory change, which leads to cellular exudate and finally leads to the degeneration of connective tissue, including the gingival fibers. So which happens just apical to the junctional epithelium. So then what happens? It leads to the collagen fiber destruction in the area, and this will be occupied by inflammatory cells and edema. You can see in this picture that neutrophils, the cells will be predominating neutrophils. There will be phagocytic action. As a result, there will be increased amount of cellular fluid and exudate, and which causes the connective tissue destruction, including gingival fibers, and which leads to the apical to the junctional epithelium, and where collagen fibers will also be destroyed, and which becomes occupied by inflammatory cells and edema. So how this collagen fibers get destroyed? Of collagen loss, it could be either due to two mechanisms. That is, first one, that is the fibroblast forming of nuclear leukocytes. Macrophages, they provide the enzymes, collagenase, and that degrades the collagen and also into small peptides. So the enzymes that degrade collagen and other matrix macromolecules into small peptides, they are called matrix metalloproteinases. So that is the first mechanism. And the second mechanism is by the fibroblasts that phagocytose the collagen fibers, which extends the cytoplasmic processes into the ligaments, cerebellum, interface, and which degrade the inserted collagen fibrils and the fibrils of the cementum matrix. Then, as a consequence of this collagen loss, you can see that the epithelial cells of the junctional epithelium gets when there is loss of collagen here, the epithelial cells of the junctional epithelium proliferate along the root. So once it gets proliferated, when it gets freed, what happens? The coronal portion of this detaches from the apical portion as the apical portion migrates. So when there is that is more like when there is proliferation, it is more like finger-like projections that are 2 or 3 cells in thickness. So then what happens? The coronal detachment happens. So as a result of this inflammation, you can see that polymorphonuclear neutrophils increases in the coronal part. So they will be acting on the phagocytic action in the connective tissue. So when there is a relative volume of femoris reaches approximately 60%, what happens? The tissue loses cohesiveness and detaches from the tooth surface. So which ultimately leads to the pocket formation. So then the sulcus bottom shifts apically, and more or circular epithelium will be forming, increasing in this portion and forming the lining of the periodontal pocket. So next, coming to the visual cycle that we have already discussed, that is, plaque is the main reason for the formation of this gingival inflammation, gingivitis, and this which leads to either a false pocket or a true pocket, and which ultimately, if it is not getting treated, and again it's going to be more plaque formation. So the main rationale for pocket reduction is based on the need to eliminate areas of plaque accumulation. So where you can see that there is pocket formation and there is plaque accumulation here. So it's like normal brushing, conventional tooth brushing is unable to clean areas properly. So where there is need of professional care. So coming to the features of lateral pocket wall, there will be severe DMBD changes. You can see that epithelial cells would be striking proliferative and degenerative changes, and they will be densely infiltrated against the leukocytes and edema from the inflamed connective tissue. And this progressive degeneration and necrosis of the epithelium finally leads to the ulceration of the lateral wall, exposure of the underlying inflamed connective tissue, and separation. Microtopography of the gingival bowl. You can see the different areas that is first one, the areas of the relative kissings, areas of bacterial accumulation, areas of emergence of leukocytes, areas of leukocyte bacterial interaction, then areas of intense epithelial desquamation, areas of ulceration, and areas of hemorrhage with numerous erythrocytes. Okay, then coming to the pockets as healing lesion, that you can see that periodontal pockets are chronic inflammatory lesions, that is, which undergoes repair constantly, where complete healing does not occur because of the persistence of the bacterial attack, which continues to stimulate the inflammatory response again, so which causes degeneration of elements formed at the time of the repair. So you can see that this is the interplay between the destructive tissue changes and the conservative tissue changes. So when there is destructive tissue changes, it leads to the change in the gingival features, that is color, consistency, surface texture of the focal wall, everything will get changed and will form to the destruction of the periodontal tissues and the pocket wall. So this in healing, you can see that either it could be due to leads to edematous pocket wall or fibrotic pocket wall. That is, if inflammatory cells and edema predominate, what happens? It leads to edematous pocket wall. And if there is predominance of the new formed connective tissue cells and fibers, which leads to fibrotic pocket wall. Then coming to the pocket contents, so it consists of salivary mucins, gingival fluid, desquamate epithelial cells, leukocytes, and obviously microorganisms and their products like enzymes, endotoxins, and other metabolic products, and of course food remnants. So then coming to the root surface wall of periodontal pocket, this is also significant because they may perpetuate the periodontal infection, which cause pain and complicate the periodontal treatment. As we know that as the pocket deepens, what happens? There will be collagen dominance of the Sharpie's fibers in the cementum, which undergo degeneration. So which leads to the penetration of bacteria in the cementodendral junction and also enter the dendral tubules. So when there is exposure and endurance of the dendral tubules, the fragmentation and breakdown of the cementum surface occurs, and there will be areas of necrotic cementum separated from the tooth by the masses of bacteria. Coming to the surface morphology of tooth wall, so there are different zones, that is cementum covered by calculus, attached plaque, zone of unattached plaque, zone where the dentinal epithelium is attached to the tooth, so which will be reduced in periodontal pockets, and that is zone of semi-destroyed connective tissue fibers. So in this picture, you can see that it is covered by zone of calculus, that is, then it is covering, attached plaque is covering the calculus, that is the attached plaque, which is of diameter like 100 to 500 μm, and then comes the zone of unattached plaque here. And then coming to the junctional epithelium, so which is usually more than this. So in periodontal pockets, it will get reduced to 100 μm. Then coming to the zone of semi-destroyed connective tissue fibers, and all these three, 4 and 5, that is these three zones make the plaque-free zone in extracted teeth. Coming to the periodontal disease activity, as you know, that is periodontal disease progression is very continuous and slow, and that is mainly the specificity of bacteria is important, that mainly determines the periodontal disease activity. So according to this concept, the periods of activity will be followed by periods of inactivity. So periods of quiescence or inactivity, in which there is a reduced inflammatory response, and also there will be less, little or no loss of bone and connective tissue attachment. And you can see that periods of exacerbation or activity, you can see that unattached plaque. So where there will be harboring of unattached plaque, and which will be flooded with the gram-negative, motile and aerobic bacteria, so which there will be like bone and clinical attachment loss are seen, the disc ink attachment level will be lost and the pocket get deepened. So coming to the site specificity, so periodontal destruction will get progressed. It's a continuous process, but it will be different from different areas and different teeth. So that is why we are coming to the specificity, that is periodontal destruction occurs on a few teeth at a time, or even only on some aspects of some teeth at a very given time. It is very common to find sites of periodontal destruction next to sites with little or no destruction. Severity of periodontal destruction increases the development of new engaged sites and increases the breakdown of existing sites. That is why we are telling that it is not the severity of periodontal disease is not determined by the periodontal pocket depth. So that is, more destruction can be seen or more attachment loss can be seen even in shallow pocket depth. Then coming to the relation of attachment loss and bone loss to pocket depth. Severity of attachment and bone loss is generally but not always correlated with the depth of the pocket. So pockets of the same depth may be associated with different degrees of attachment loss, you can see, and pockets of different depths may be associated with the same amount of attachment loss. That is why we are telling that even if there is, it is not determined, the pocket depth is, the periodontitis, the intensity of periodontitis is not determined by the pocket depth. Then coming to the detection of pockets, the only accurate method is by the careful exploration with periodontal probe. This cannot be detected on radiograph, or you can use the Gattapaccio points or calibrated silver points can be used along with the radiograph. And probing depth depends upon direction of penetration, force, size of probe, and the resistance of the tissue and convexity of crown. Coming to the types of pocket depths that you know, that is biological pocket depth or clinical probing depth. Histology pocket depth, that is the actual pocket depth that is histologically measuring, that is, which is the total of junctional epithelium. So distance between gingival margin and the base of the pocket. So clinical probing depth, that is what we are probing, penetrating or probe into pocket. So this probing technique, like it is, probe is inserted parallel to the long axis of the tooth. So in the diagram you can see that it should be inserted parallel to the long axis of the tooth and walked circumferentially, and it should be like stepping. That is what called this walking the probe. So this will reaching the deepest areas of detect the areas of deepest penetration. So there are different types of probes. Generations of probes have been evolved. That is, first one, that is a conventional type of probe or manual probe, that what we are using in the clinics. Second one, that we have the probe with control force application, that is, or otherwise called true sensitive probe. So this will be guiding the force. So that is the true sensitive probe of the second generation. Third generation, that is probes with control force application, automated and computer one. So that is what we are we have this diagram. And fourth one, that is under development in the aims at recording sequential probe positions along the gingival sulcus. And the fifth one would have an ultrasonic device attached to the fourth generation probe for identifying attachment level without penetrating it. Then coming to the methods of pocket therapy, that is, we have new attachment technique or removal of pocket wall or removal of the side of the pocket. So removal of the side of the pocket, that is by the root resection or extraction, can be done to avoid eliminate the pocket. And then that is the removal of pocket wall, that is by syringe or a surgical removal by gingivectomy can do the pocket elimination, or by the apical displacement or apical flap. And new attachment procedure, that is what we are aiming, that is the ideal result, because they eliminate the pocket by reuniting the gingiva to the tooth, which may lead to a filling in of bone or and the regeneration of periodontal ligament and cementum. So coming to the pocket therapy, that is, it could be like non-surgical method or surgical method. First we will go with the facement therapy, and that is non-surgical therapy that you know, that is scaling and root planing. So scaling root planing, that is, here the picture shows scaling, that is more with the supragingival calculus and some amount of subgingival calculus. And deeper pockets, we will use the root planing to plane the surface plane the root surface along with the curettage, and then local term delivery can be done. So under surgical method, either you can go directly with the curettage, gingivectomy, flap surgery, and distal molar surgery. And under flap surgery, there could be resective surgery or reconstructive surgery. So resective surgery, as an indice, we will be resecting or eliminating the pocket lining directly, that is why modified Whitman flap epically displays or non-displays. And under reconstructive surgery, we have papillary preservation and unmeasured flap. All the flap procedures you will be studying later on. Let's conclude that is periodontal pocket formation causes loss of attachment of the gingiva and degradation of the root surface. The severity of attachment loss is not always associated with the depth of the pocket. Pockets of same depth may be associated with varying clinical presentations, and the pockets of different depths may be associated with same amount of attachment loss. So presence of periodontal pocket can act as a marker of a disease but do not correlate with the severity of periodontal disease. So that's all for today.